Brad.
I'm David.
I'm Dan.
Adam.
Ryan.
And this is The Catch. So the agenda for today, we're going to talk about the background, we're going to go over the key features, we're going to go over the mechanisms, and we're going to have some time for some questions. So the background for this toy, the story, we got two guys going out on the lake, going to have a great day of fishing. They've already got four fish in the boat, so they're having a great day. The guy in the back is doing the paddling, the guy in the front is doing the fishing. And for the concept of this toy, what we really wanted to do is store energy within a spring and then change that mechanical rotational energy to paddling and fishing motions with the mechanisms that we put into this toy. As far as who would be interested in this toy, we're looking at anybody who would enjoy a bath time toy or a child who is interested in mechanical systems. And the beauty of the mechanical motor is we don't need any batteries or electricity, so that makes it very applicable for a bath time toy.
Yeah, so one of the key features is, of course, rowing. So when the user is playing with the toy in the bathtub, we wanted the toy to actually propel itself forward. And to do so, we wanted to have some sort of realistic motion. As you can see with these two pictures, we have the two ranges of motion essentially of the rower, where in the top picture, he's all the way back, you know, paddling, and then the bottom picture, he's all the way forward, raising the oars up. If you go to the next slide. To do so, we actually connected our oars and paddles together using a gear from the spring motor. The picture on the top shows our actual rower, and his legs are going to be mounted to the boat itself, fixed. His torso pivots freely, and the arms are connected to each other with a square shaft. It should be noted that the torso is hollowed out in the sense that the arms can move relative to each other, but it doesn't have any resistance inside the torso. The bottom picture you can see here is the actual oar being connected into its assembly. So it goes oar into a little peg. And then we have our really ultra-low friction sleeve bearing. These three parts are then assembled into the walls of the toy. A gear is glued onto the peg, and the little, we'll call this like a handle, is connected to the oar. This essentially allows the rower to have a horizontal grabbing point that he can hold onto throughout the entire range of motion.
So the next feature we wanted to do, we toyed around with a couple ideas, but we finally ended up with, we wanted the guy in the front to go fishing and pull some fish out of the water. We toyed around with having the fishing rod as the motion move the fishing rod, but what we finally decided on was to cut a 1-inch, 1.5-inch square out of the front seat, and then pin the back of that seat to the side seat of the boat, and then use that flapping motion to move the fisherman. And then, as you can see, the fisherman and the fishing pole and the fish are all static, and so they all follow this about 15 degree motion of the seat. Right here is the seat, and then we've got a cam that is belt driven directly from the motor right here, so that when the motor has a rotational spin, it spins the belt that drives the cam, and the fisherman follows at about 15 degrees.
So one of the more fun aspects of this course was surface modeling, and we wanted to throw a few instances of that in our product to kind of spruce up the design. So for instance, the guy in the front, he's relaxing, catching some fish, he's letting his facial hair grow out, he's got his pipe. The guy in the back is clean shaven, he can't be encumbered by anything in his mouth, he's working hard. In addition to that, the surface modeling and other extrusions we were able to separate them surface by surface and give the model a more or less realistic paint job. The fishing pole in our physical prototype, we used a real fishing line on it, but in the model we were able to do that through the sweep. And the fish is actually modeled after a walleye pike. So he's fighting pretty hard. We're hoping it's outside the slot and he can take it home. In order to emulate a real feel for this toy, we took all of our major dimensions and scaled them down from real life objects such as the boat and the oar, and we actually used the 50th percentile of Army surveys for a lot of the human dimensions on our rovers.
Yeah, and another big point for our toy that's going to be used in the bathtub is, of course, buoyancy, so we can't have this thing sink. So we spent a good amount of time making sure that the center mass was in the center of the boat, so that wasn't too far forward, too far back. so the water level is relatively level. And then we also made sure that the water level is, of course, going to be below the top of the boat. So, you know, finding the density of the extruded plastic and then making those calculations. As you can see here, we actually have our prototype in the water, and we have about a half inch gap between the top of the water and the top of the boat, reiterating that, you know, this toy can be used in the bathtub and won't sink. And I'd like to show you guys two videos. The one on the left is going to be our Creo simulation model, reiterating the motion, where you have a back rower who has somewhat realistic motion, paddling, and then you have a front fisherman who is trying to reel in the big catch. The video on the right is a slow motion video of the actual mechanism in water operating. As you can see, the guy in the back is paddling the boat, and the fisherman in the front is trying to get that fish out of the water.
One of the biggest difficulties we had to deal with in this project was getting the motor to give us a reasonable amount of torque. We got this motor from a vintage toy store online, and it's actually meant for toy cars, where you have a vertical input shaft and a horizontal shaft for the output. But the horizontal shaft had such little torque that what we ended up doing was flipping the motor on its side and cutting off the bottom half of that axle so they could fit in the boat, and the output shaft of the motor was actually became our input shaft so that we could get a higher torque on our output. There were no specs on this motor. It was a vintage toy shop. There wasn't a lot we could find out about it, so tried to make the best, but it's still a little difficult to use.
With that being said, is there any questions?
So I was looking to, you said there's no batteries, but how do you get the motor to spin up?
It's a wind-up motor.
A wind-up?
Yeah. Sorry.
Okay. It's a wind-up swing motor. Yeah.
From a vintage toy car.
Yeah. Do you run it?
After we painted it, I would say it's a little hard to operate right now, which is why we took a video before painting. We can go back to that slide of it operating, but I think I tested it probably 20, 30 times, and it did exactly what we thought it was going to do. Essentially, with the spring motor, we were able to get around 3 revolutions of oars and about 1 revolution of the fisherman, which we didn't want the fisherman to be moving too fast. We wanted him to be like he was fishing, right? But we wanted the rower to be like he was actually rowing the entire duration.
Another setback to changing the input and output shafts was that it takes a lot of input now to produce 1 revolution of output. The ratio is, we kind of reversed the gear ratio, so that adds some difficulty.
Where's the wind, how do you wind it up?
Yeah, it's in here. This has got a little wind.
There you go.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Perhaps, what would you do? Do more research on wind up?
I would say, the big issue we came up with was, of course, the power source, and everything that we were looking up online, there was, of course, a plethora of different options out there, but you had to buy them in bulk, and we weren't going to buy 10,000 wind-up motors to find out they weren't going to be right one. We would do a lot more research into wind-up toys. We really wanted to stick with the wind-up concept, really just perfecting that if we have future iterations.
Actually, I collected about 40 to 50 wind-up toys. Unfortunately, they're all small and serve your purpose.
Yeah, we were thinking about that.
That's kind of what we did with this. It was supposed to go into an old metal something from the 50s.
You bought it wrong right up twice.
Yeah. All right, any other questions? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.